of the general clause is that I think if a new section or a new act comes into play, it has to be read into the whole, you know, wherever the old section of the old place is. Because similarly in income tax, even whether under 219AA is defined as under section 390 or 392. Now do we say that, you know, if you put under 230 or 232, it is not a demerger as defined under the income tax, it can't be read that way. Because of the general clause that I think it will come into play and it will help from an overall reading, you know, in a harmonious manner. But we should change, I mean, to say the least, because otherwise, you know, there will be dichotomy, there will be some officer present for the general clause that will make us do an appeal and then we'll have to fight it out and get it at a different level. So I think changes are required, not that they are not required. Foreign direct investments, again important. You know, from an overall perspective, so if I look at the Sun Pharma Brandaxi merger, you know, shares were issued to Taiichi as a result of that merger. And the question was, does this require, because it was pharma industry, pharma needs FDI approval. And, you know, Taiichi never had an FDI approval for Sun Pharma shares. It had for Amrish shares, but it never had for Sun Pharma. So, does it require, to my mind, yes. And that approval is preliminary. Just because you are invested in a company which is now not there, and you are now going to get shares of a new company on a merger, doesn't make it automatic if your sector is still requiring you to get that approval. So obviously one needs to look at that, because sectoral approvals are equally important. There is no sector or regulator here, but it is important. So let's say in insurance, does anything happen without IRDA? If you look at the recent SBI life insurance deal, they had to go to IRDA to get a new investor in and get the approvals. Now it's important, it's part of the sectoral requirement, and you can't say that no, it is not needed, less than 5%, why is it needed? But insurance works in a different way. The IRDA works in a different way. They need an approval, they need an approval. So I think that's very important again to get sectoral approval. Indirect tax, again, I think primarily. What we see, whether it is shares, whether it is mergers, whether it is demergers, generally is tax neutral. Issue is around exemptions and incentives and, you know, whatever we have claimed and how we, you know, carry forward them basically, and standard credits basically. How do we carry forward them into the new company? So planning around that needs to be slightly appropriate here. SEBI, I think Ketan mentioned some examples, but you know, there are several issues around that. And I think we see new and new guidelines come from SEBI. So the latest one which has come a week back, or at least debated at the board meeting and will come out anytime, is around this requirement that an unlisted company is merging with a listed company. And the public shareholder of a listed company, shareholding, is reduced by more than 5%. Then we need to go and get an approval of the public shareholder. Now there are already several approvals which are there. NCLT has prescribed a set of approvals which are there earlier under, you know, companies and perspective under IPO, where we need majority in value, a majority number, 3/4 in value. Now, one more is there under the listing regulations, where we need to get, you know, an approval of shareholders in certain cases, where you are merging companies in owned by the promoters or any of those things. There are several such things, there is one more now that is needed. And you know what they have said is, for unlisted company, what they will determine as public shareholding is only QIB holdings. So look at any scenario where an unlisted company is merging into a listed entity, and the unlisted shareholders are neither getting a board seat, nor becoming a majority shareholder, not getting maybe more than 25% shareholding, but public they will not be counted, because only QIB holding in unlisted company is counted as public. So suddenly I have to go and get an approval of my shareholders apart from what is required under company act. So you know, this entire ease of doing business part, I think they just need to realign to say that when you are doing the, you know, the entire voting under company act, please do it in two parts. Companies that require everybody's shareholder to vote, and the calculation is around that part. And the second part is just consider what is the public shareholder. Just too simple. Why prescribe one more on top of it? whatever is prescribed there is still the same. Because ultimately you can only count voting of people who voted. You can't, you know, force people to vote. If they don't vote, they don't vote. If they vote anyway, you will count it. So, you know, this multiplicity is where the entire issue comes up. And therefore, you know, we should go through it today. But I think that's the type of representations that are being made. Because otherwise, you know, there is duplication, which is not warranted. Companies Act again, maybe we'll have a session from Sanjay later. I think a lot of disclosures are required now. I think including valuation reports to be part of the, you know, statements that we give. There are certain things there which I think is going to be very, very nightmarish in terms of calling off shareholder creditors meeting, because the Act requires that it is voting is done within 30 days. And the rules require that at least a 30-day time period is given to the shareholders and to the creditors. So I don't know which to follow, frankly. I mean, it's a problem. I think one needs to go and change the rules, or one needs to say that the rule will override the Act because they have power under that category section of 464 or something like that. But otherwise, if there are two, I don't know how a tribunal member is ever going to, you know, give you one. Or should we just say that whatever it is, ordered by the tribunal is what we have followed. But if this comes up before then, it's going to be knowing how they are going by the Act and the rules, it's going to be really, really problem. Competition Act again, I think liberalized last year, so I think that's a good thing. I think it's one agency, I must say, I think it has been quite fair. We've not heard too many negatives from this agency in terms of its approval. You know, in the manner of approval, the way they are approving. So I think that's, I think, a good sign. And I'm just hoping that the NCLT also has a similar way of looking at things, just like how the Competition Commission is looking at it. So that's very important. And how we need to plan around all of this. Because, you know, if you look at things, it should not happen tomorrow that you've gone through everything. And then, you know, a regulator or an exchange control violation comes up. So it can't be that. Or a stamp duty issue comes up, then nearly your entire, you know, planning or entire need to do a restructuring can fall flat. So it's very, very important that we move around, you know, in this gamut of laws and see to it that, you know, we're covering all bases. There are not many sections, but, you know, obviously the interplay amongst this is very, very important. And, you know, obviously a solution that you may want to draw out needs to be drawn out in light of that.
We covered, I think, just in terms of an M&A process quickly, what are the things that one would look at? Tax neutrality clearly, I think, is one of the most important things. Tax exemption, that benefits being continued, tax credits being available, and whether you can, you know, claim depreciation on an enhanced cost basis. I think that's very important. If I go to SEBI, if I am looking at, you know, merging a listed company to an unlisted company, then the listing of new shares is one of the most important priorities. And how do I get over it? Takeover code in case of acquisition. So business acquisitions don't have takeover code issues, but share acquisitions do have that. So that's very important. And then, you know, how do I comply with them? And mergers acquisitions, as we all know, as stock exchange approvals and SEBI approval, not directly but through the stock exchange. Cross-border will cover a little bit on BEPS, there are certain developments happening. So just one more thing on cross-border is, today, the way, let's say you have a foreign company and you have an Indian company, and if you want to merge a foreign company into an Indian company, then what happens around it, I think we will just talk about it slightly later. So I'm just parking this because, you know, it's important today because there is a critical issue around that. Stamp duty again is linked to shares generally all over or remote property, and set off of stamp duty I think again is going to be a critical element. So do we get set off of stamp duty if we have, you know, merging companies in different jurisdictions, and what happens in that scenario?
Exchange control we spoken about.
Accounting, as I said, we'll cover later. So quickly, I think what are types of domestic mergers that we've seen? Simple merging company A into company B. So if you look at, you know, the scenario of Red Maxi versus Sun Pharma, this is what it was. Or we could have more than one company merge into a third company. That's the second scenario that one can do that. We've seen a lot of subsidiary companies merge into holding companies. And here, I think, is where in certain states it's possible to plan around the stamp duty. So if you want to acquire, you know, a company or acquire a business or acquire an asset of a company, you would rather acquire the shares if it is an asset heavy company. Because acquisition of shares generally will demand it, you know, shares will be demanded, there is no stamp duty. And if it is Maharashtra, then you just hold that subsidiary company into yourself and you don't pay any stamp duty. Because in Maharashtra, the way the stamp duty law is, you know, prescribed, if you don't issue any consideration in the form of shares or cash, then there is no stamp duty. And when a subsidiary company merges into a parent, 100% subsidiary company merges into a parent, there is no issue of shares. Since there is no issue of shares or any other consideration, there is no stamp duty. So this is used, you know, in terms of stamp duty planning. I want the business, but here I went to and acquire the shares, my stamp duty cost is going to be high. So I think, you know, it's a reverse way of looking at it, I mean, from that perspective. And holding company merging into subsidiary. So we've seen this primarily because of, you know, certain groups or certain promoter holdings through companies and multiple layer of BD being applied, where we don't hold more than 50% shares. So you just hold those companies into the, you know, operating company with that dealer is, so that you become a direct shareholder. This can also happen in a scenario where you are likely to sell your shares at a future date. So if you were to keep the holdco structure, so this is the bottom bullet on the right hand side or the bottom picture on the right hand side. If you keep the holdco structure, if you were to sell your shares in listed entity through the stock exchange, you might still get capital gains exemption, but you will not get MAT exemption. So if you were to fold the holdco into the listed entity, then as an individual you would hold direct shares. If you were then to sell it on the exchange, then there is no MAT implication and there is no capital gains implication. So then it can be used in different ways. If you are going to continue, then for DDT selling, if you are going to, you know, sell it at some point of time in the near future, then you plan your MAT much in advance rather than at the time of, you know, doing the sale. So one can think of, you know, several options here where this can be done. Because if you see some of this private equity investment had happened in the holding company, whether it was Shriram, whether it was Giro Andal, and then, you know, those companies merged below into the operating entities, and therefore the private equity investors bought the shares directly whenever they wanted to divest, they would have divested. So the investment in the holding company was made with the purpose or with the perspective that it is going to launch into the operating entity. So that there is an exit route that is made available to investors, and then the promoters are not obliged, you know, to buy it out from the investors. So that's how it works. It's a different situation again, and you know, different results for different purposes by people do that. Going to cross-border, as I said again, basically there are two or three aspects here. So if there is a foreign company which is owning an Indian company and it merges into another foreign company, therefore the shareholders of foreign company, one gets the shares of foreign company. Now clearly here, because of our indirect transfer rules, I think we need to be very careful. So if India is going to have substantial value in foreign company one, therefore foreign company one derives its value from India, then the shareholders of foreign company one would be subject to tax when they receive shares of foreign company two. Because what is exempted is the transfer between foreign company one and foreign company two. But what is yet not exempted is what happens when the shareholders swap their shares. You know, because they, instead of FC1 shares, they will get FC2 shares. And if you look at the recent circular, which is now pressing date or, you know, capital appearance, it clearly said that the shareholders will be subject to tax. So I think the intention of the CBDT is out on this one, that, you know, they would like to tax the shareholders. So the ask from the industry is that, you know, it should be tax neutral through and through. So long as it is tax neutral, that jurisdiction, it should be tax neutral in India. You can't have a different currency
if you're providing the neutrality at the company level, you're going to provide it at the shareholder level. So that's how I think you ask this.
The next one is, and this is important, and I like to. So we always ask this question at the company that can a foreign company merge into an Indian company? And I think the general answer at the company that till few days back was yes, it can be merged. Because of this transfer to NCLT, what the notification has come on Companies Act is all sections which are there are notified except for the cross-border merger section. Now, this is what has happened from MCA. Now, look at what the High Court has done. The High Court has, on the other hand, passed a notification saying that all matters under 390 or 394 will be passed on the NCLT. So what happens if I have a merger of a foreign company into an Indian company? High Court is not very present to it because it has passed notification saying everything passes through. NCA recognizes the benefits. NCA is saying this section is not notified. So now there is no section in the Companies Act, at least practically speaking, which deals with the cross-border merger. So last 1 month, there is one matter in the Bombay High Court where there has been an argument made that since this section is not notified, for that related merger, 390 or 394 should be used. So the judge has heard us, we are awaiting the order, but it's going to be a tricky one because you know he will have to be obliged by the notification of the High Court to say all 390 or 394 matters will be passed. NCLT members are saying we don't have jurisdiction, so don't even come here. So that's the dichotomy which has got created. And I think, you know, why this is happening is just because of one thing. Because the cross-border merger section of the new Companies Act 2013 talks of jurisdictions that will be notified by the government from where cross-border mergers will be run. But I have a very simple question to ask. If it is an inbound merger, if a foreign company is merging into India, why do you need to need a jurisdiction to be notified? Wherever it is coming into India, it is going to be disclosed to your ROC, you know, all of those, whatever will happen, once your balance sheet is filed. I can understand the reverse. Anyway, one company that did not allow the reverse. So you at least stop, only the reverse if you want to stop. Just say that this is notified and this is the jurisdiction that is allowed. For the balance will be notified later. So that you know there is no stoppage or something, because the scheme was filed and NCLT was not there. Now we don't know where to go between the High Court and the NCLT. So we are just being, you know, a football today, you know, being kicked by both sides, and we don't know where we will end up. I'm definitely not scoring a goal, that I know. But you know it's not a good situation to be. And you know, you have planned on certain basis, you want to close it, you know, because in the current fiscal year and you know it's anyway running short. So I think that's very important, and today I think there is a big, big issue that has come up because of this notification. And I think new companies that as and when it comes into play in this section will allow Indian companies to be merged into foreign companies. So I think that's a very progressive step as and when it happens. The question is, will it practically play out? You know, because A, foreign exchange regulation needs to change. B, SEBI regulations need to change. Three, income tax regulations need to change. Because when an Indian company merges into a foreign company, it is not tax neutral as far as the shareholders are concerned or the Indian company is concerned. When SEBI has to set a listed Indian company, I'll just take an example. For example, if Hindustan Unilever wants to merge with Unilever PLC, will SEBI say that this is delisting of HUL, therefore you have to follow the delisting regulations? Or we will say, okay, you are still getting a you know, liquid stock, but of Unilever PLC. And you create a mechanism of how to deal with it. Because I am about to invest in, you know, a foreign company share through the remittance scheme. There is no stoppage for individual also in that $150,000 scheme. I am allowed to invest. So treat it as that and allow this to happen. What happens if somebody is high stake in your case?
if its value is more than $450,000, what happens? Because RBI guidelines is more regular.
So they have to come up with a law, because just doing it in companies that cannot go to work. You know, SEBI needs to change, RBI and FEMA needs to change, and income tax obviously needs to change. Otherwise, this is not coming at all. And nobody will plan around it, because it's a huge taxation issue, obviously approval issues, and we are not sure whether we will get that approval. So RBI has been forthcoming that once this is notified, they will quickly look at it and they will make whatever necessary changes. But I'm not too sure about SEBI at this stage on this one.
Domestic demerger situations again, you know, you see a division getting demerged and going into the holding company. Why would one do that? Why would one, you know, create it? The idea is that if you are looking at selling one of the two, then you might want to, you know, try and create an opportunity and try and create value. So people would want to do it. Second option is that, okay, if there are too many losses, the division has not able to, you know, absorb them, and you are necessarily paying taxes for holding company. So if you realign yourself, maybe a part of the losses can get absorbed, and to an extent the group as a whole can save on taxes. That's another reason why people would do this. This could be internal, could be external. One just needs to be, you know, looking at it in the way that it serves the purpose. And why would I do it? Why would I not merge the holding subsidiary into myself and just do whatever it is? You know, because again, if you look at 72A, there are different set of rules for mergers and different set of rules for demergers. And the set of rules for demergers are much easier to observe. There are no preconditions, there are no postconditions. But for mergers, there are preconditions. That I should be owning 75% of the assets 2 years prior to, and all of those. There are no post conditions like direct merger, that, you know, install capacity I should use at least more than, you know, 50% of the 450 year. So all of those conditions are not there. And therefore demerger becomes more attractive than a merger. Even in terms of timeline also, because I don't need to go to the office to regulator in a demerger scenario, it is faster than going, you know, for a merger where there is an office to regulator anymore. Another problem extra. If I'm crunched on timeline also, I will do it. If it gives me broadly the same result. So I think there are several aspects here that one looks at it and why one looks at demerger process. And obviously, if it is a service industry or financial services industry, you mentioned, then obviously you don't have a choice if you want to offset the loss. You can't think of a merger, you have to think of a demerger. So if you look at